welcome back to DGen Valley. Today we have a special guest, Jonathan Covey from ZetaChain. Can you kind of, let's start off with us just kind of getting into it. Can you kind of tell us what ZetaChain is all about, kind of like what its main use cases are and, you know, where you see yourself in the space?
Yeah, so ZetaChain is building the first public blockchain with built-in omni-chain interoperability. So like, why is interoperability even important in the first place? Like, we're at a point in crypto right now where things are pretty fragmented and blockchains are very much closed by design. And so the ability to move data and value from one chain to another today is pretty confusing for users. Like, you got to make sure you have the right gas assets and you're managing multiple wallets across different networks. And in many cases, you're not getting the actual native tokens. And there's been a lot of hacks, and you may have read headlines about lots of exploits and crypto lost because of some of the current approaches. And so the vision behind ZetaChain is to provide a public decentralized blockchain that enables omni-chain interoperability of all data and value. And for developers, this means being able to build applications that work across all chains, and the users on those apps can fluidly experience different chains and safely, affordably move value and data around. So that's the big thing we're trying to tackle.
That's the whole utility. So it's a big deal right now for people that don't understand this. There's quite literally hundreds of blockchains, right? Like, there's some main like front runners. Obviously everyone knows Ethereum, Bitcoin, Solana, like you name it. There's like a few out there, but the difficulty is that you can't really interact with these different chains if you have one token on versus another, right? So you have to use something like a bridge. You have to wrap your token. That's really the only way right now that most people kind of can interact between these different chains. And like, what you're proposing is that ZetaChain is essentially allowing this interoperability where you can take currency, or you can write a dApp that is essentially exchanges a currency from one to another, right? Pretty easily, from what I understand.
Yeah, like one of the big use cases is just sending value to other people and doing that cross chain. So there's a lot of demand for cross chain, and that's one of the big use cases of ZetaChain. But even more than that, it's like, how do you build apps that do other stuff like AMMs and DEXs and like identity and social profiles? How do those live across other chains, and how can you bring them into games and use your NFTs across different chains? So it really impacts everything.
Yeah. When we're talking about interoperability and we're talking about ZetaChain, you know, what do you support right now? Because right now, obviously, you don't support all these different chains yet, right? Like, you kind of have to do it kind of piece by piece, if I'm not mistaken, right? Like, you're probably aiming first. And I mean, we can kind of talk about this in a little bit, because you announced that there's like a new update that you guys featured on your testnet, which is Bitcoin, right? Like, you guys are able to interact with Bitcoin now within your testnet. Nice. That's a big deal.
Yeah.
So which other major chains are you kind of going after? And I mean, you don't have to necessarily spill all the beans, but what do you see kind of within the next couple of years?
Yeah. Well, the public ones right now, a number of EVM compatible chains, Polygon, Ethereum, Clayton, who's also a strategic partner of ours. The big omni-chain smart contract release last week enabled something like Bitcoin support, the ability to natively swap Bitcoin cross-chain. And all of this is on testnet, by the way. Yeah. So we're continuing to build out the important chains and bring them into our ecosystem of like universal connectivity. And we're consulting community and what devs care about to inform those decisions. And then bringing on new assets and stuff. So the big focus right now is just battle testing, testnet, and finding different launch partners for these different omni-chain use cases.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, the chain stuff will happen over time. But the cool thing about Zeta Chain is we make the integration, and then developers and applications on Zeta Chain can just kind of toggle on and off the ability to leverage those networks. They don't have to worry about building custom bridges. We're kind of their partner for that.
Yeah. And I mean, it seemed like, if I'm not mistaken, and you might not know this either, but I had heard that October of this year was one of the biggest hacks for bridges, right? So I think there was like billions of dollars liquidity kind of just like stolen. And for people that don't quite understand this, obviously you're here to sort of replace bridges, right? Like in a lot of ways, where people don't necessarily have to hold their assets in these dApps that essentially what happens is when things get wrapped, they stay there stagnant until the transaction's been complete. So that's kind of when hackers have their opportunity to steal this asset.
Yeah.
Right. And with you, it's, you guys aren't doing wrapped tokens, or you guys aren't doing wrapped coins or anything like that. Right. It's
right. Yeah. So yeah, people read these headlines, like it's close to 2 billion lost in 2022. And these cross-chain bridges have largely been responsible for that. And you described it, like they don't actually settle your tokens on like natively on the destination chain. Rather, they take your assets and sort of lock it in a parking lot and issue an underlying representation of it. Mm-hmm. And so you have all of this money stuck in between blockchains, you could imagine. And there's this pattern where user risk accrues and hackers are more and more incentivized to go and exploit it. So yeah, wrapping creates all sorts of interdependency. The way that Zeta Chain solves it is through what's called a one-way peg mechanism. So the only value and data that could move cross-chain in Zeta Chain's ecosystem is the Zeta token. Mm-hmm. And so if you're doing a cross-chain swap, for example, Zeta Chain would burn X amount, peg it to Zeta, like the equivalent value, and then mint that on the destination chain. And so reduces the attack surface and its immediate settlement.
Okay. I know we kind of been talking about Zeta Chain just to kind of give people the idea of like what it is and what your utility is within the space. Would you say then that like some of your major competitors would be like Polkadot, like Cosmos? Is that kind of who you look at as kind of like that layer zero kind of target audience? Is that kind of who you guys look at internally as your major competitors?
Yeah. And like, that's who we want people to compare us to and dig under the hood and learn about the differences for a while. And still we're mentioned in articles with some of the next gen cross-chain messaging protocols like a layer zero or Axelar. But at the end of the day, we're an L1 blockchain, and part of the problem we're trying to solve with like Polkadot or Cosmos is that they have pretty tight interoperability in their ecosystems with different tech modules that they've rolled out, but you have to adopt those tech modules in order to experience interoperability, like Cosmos IBC, for example. And so what we're trying to do is extend Cosmos IBC and enable connection with all other chains like Bitcoin, no limitation, and devs don't have to adopt any unique standards or anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's like anti-fragmentation in that sense. So we're not like a lot of projects in this space try to bring as much of the ecosystem as they can into their own, and that's not our ethos.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're much more friendly.
Yeah.
I would say like other layer ones feel much more competitive in terms of like, I don't know how to explain this, but like if you run into another layer one at a party, usually there's like a little bit of contention, it feels like. And like with you guys, it doesn't feel like that at all.
No.
It feels like you guys very much want everyone to be on the same playing field. And like from what I've read on like your documentation and sort of some of your other team members when they talk on other podcasts and have their own spill, is that you guys want everyone to have their own ecosystems. Like you just want to connect them all. Like you want everyone to be able to like interact with each other in a safe way where there's not hacks and people can like live in this pretty decent world without your money being stolen all the different times, you know. Before we dive any deeper, because I know, correct me if I'm wrong, you're not a developer, right? You're head of community, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right. Yeah.
So can we kind of talk about that? Because you guys have a very healthy community. I mean, kudos to you guys. Like your Discord numbers are up there.
And Twitter.
Your Twitter numbers are up there. Like you have a decent following. It seems like people really, really want you guys to succeed. So what does that kind of look like from your perspective and how you drive a community that's so healthy? You know, because people want to be a part of it and like at least want to take part and see what you guys offer.
Yeah. And people are actually engaging too. That's something I was looking for.
Yeah. So like a lot of times for people that don't know that are on our podcast and listening, sometimes you'll join these Discords and they're dead.
Yeah.
Like they might have like 50,000 members, but like the actual daily talk is something like people are just posting kind of like tickers of like what the Bitcoin prices or Ethereum prices are. But you guys actually have a lot of interactions and people kind of excited within your community. And I think that's a big deal.
It is.
Yeah. Thank you. I empathize with projects that are just starting out. Like it was Discord was a ghost town not too long ago. I think it actually stems back to what you were just saying about the fragmentation in the space. Like all of these blockchains have their personalities and there are maxis of various chains like Bitcoin, Solana and stuff. And like, again, the ethos about what we're trying to do is make a public utility for omni-chain infrastructure, public, decentralized, plays with everyone, allows devs to experience the pros and cons of different chains, because some are good at scalability and some have other advantages. And I think people are really excited. People appreciate the interoperability problem and they're passionate about what we're trying to build.
What does that come from? Does that come from just like consistency? Like you guys are consistently putting out material for people to interact with.
Mm-hmm.
Do you guys have like how many people are on your team specifically that help with that? Or is that like everyone? Yeah. Like is that all hands on deck type of situation? Or is it mostly just fall on your shoulders or on your team's shoulders?
Yeah. Everybody wears a lot of hats. We're 18 people. What we've been able to achieve with just 18 people is, I think, pretty incredible. Like these other protocols we mentioned have like 100 something employees, like the startups and hundreds of millions in funding. Consistency is important. And I think I was telling you guys in San Francisco, the first 6 months, we just had a white paper, and it's hard for people to get behind something that's not tangible. Mm-hmm. And it was slow for a good 6 months. So we just focused on building content, writing Medium articles, tweet threads. We called them Zeta Education, Zeta Ed. All of it was on my shoulders because the team was, like five people, and the engineers were having to build out the protocol. And then we were doing contests and incentives. And so Layer 3 is a solution that we use to run fun, creative contests. Right now, people are coming up with their favorite omni-chain dApp idea. And we've been really consistent.
Yeah.
Every 2 weeks, like create a Zeta Chain blog post in a ton of different languages. So localization is really important. Videos, pose with the Zeta Chain logo in your city. We got pictures of people from all around the world. And then just like raw biz dev, we're reaching out to people and devs like to follow us on Twitter, trying to get in front of influencers and news outlets to talk about what we were doing. And it was a grind.
It's funny because when we got back, Ali was super impressed with like how many ambassadors you have.
Yeah.
Worldwide.
Yeah. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah. So one of the things we did early on was try to bootstrap an ambassador program. We were like, localization of content is important. English is still a big barrier in a lot of places. And the TAM for blockchain in general and Zeta Chain is we want anyone with a crypto wallet to use it. And so you have to be global in your approach. And so you talk on Discord, you start to suss out who really cares about what you're doing and is going out of their way to make contributions. And so you start to build trust with these profile pictures. And next thing you know, we had a pretty thriving exclusive channel, and like we're figuring out KPIs and how to provide compensation. And now the infrastructure's set up. Like we have local Twitter accounts. They're doing translation of content, and a lot of them have really embraced Zeta Chain, and they're doing like community meetups in their cities. And Russia's doing an AMA this weekend. Like 2,000 people raised their hand.
That's pretty cool.
It's really just cool.
Snowballed.
It's so wild because when you go to any conference or any event, like whether it's like NFT or, you know, layer one or gaming or, you know, whatever security, it's like the first thing they always talk about is community.
Right.
Like, you know, you have to have community to be able to like be in this space. You absolutely do. Like it's something that we're experiencing as well, trying to build it ourselves. Mm-hmm. It's just very, very cool to see someone like yourself succeeding so well in terms of building that out. And I would say that a lot of people can look at your team as kind of like a template to kind of base themselves upon, you know, yeah, like absolutely. So. Like whether you're like an NFT project, whether you're layer one, layer two, like, cause I just think you guys do such a good job. You really, really do.
Yeah.
It's really, really cool seeing, you know, a tweet in English and then like, you know, you also have one in, you know, Russian or whatever it is.
Well, yeah. Just when I was searching for your Twitter, I saw multiple accounts for like each country.
Yeah. And that's just such a cool experience.
It is.
Cause
yeah.
It's like, to me, and like we say this a lot on this show, but it's all about accessibility. Like it really is. Like whether that means it's English, whether it means it's Spanish, whether yeah. Right now it kind of feels like a lot of layer ones in particular, and the space as a whole, it kind of feels like a cultish kind of community.
Yeah.
You know, and it's cool to see someone like yourself kind of breaking that open and allowing so many people in. Especially since you guys have such a small team.
Yeah.
You know, you're absolutely right. Like most of these teams have 80 to 100 people. They have like millions and millions and millions to kind of just chuck at the wall. So it's kind of nice to see like a grassroots team kind of, you know, building this out.
Especially for somebody like me who's still trying to like get a grip on the whole blockchain community in general.
Yeah, because it is very, it's isolated. And that's just so what's refreshing about your chain, because there's a lot of isolation in this space where, you know, you go to like, what, like Ali and I, we'll go to like a Bitcoin conference or like a Bitcoin talk, and these people just want to talk about Bitcoin and they don't want to talk about anything else.
Right.
Like if you talk about Ethereum, you talk about Solana, right. Like they like want to kick you out basically. You go to Ethereum, you talk about Solana, you're going to get like chased out. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like that's kind of how it feels in this space. And it's kind of nice to have someone like yourself kind of be like, well, we want to link it all together.
Mm-hmm.
There's been other people that have tried and it hasn't worked out very well, but I think that has a lot of merit within this space to be able to link all these different communities together.
Yeah, I think so too.
I was just going to respond. Just thinking about like again the ethos of Zeta Chain and being friendly with other chains. I don't think I realize how much of an effect that has on people, because the reality is, you exclude people. if you're maximalist of a particular chain. And most people do believe in multi-chain. So
yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I would say that most people in this space definitely think there's going to be a few chains around for a while. Like there, I don't think internally, because we're obviously a layer one as well. We don't think there's just going to be one. Like there's not going to be one that controls the whole space. No. There's very much going to be quite a few with different utilities, different use cases that need to kind of interact with each other to make themselves more useful, but also the whole ecosystem as a whole.
Yeah.
And I kind of see you guys.
Especially. Yeah, just like we're in this Web3 world, but there's also the Web2 world, which is most of how the world operates right now. And as they experience blockchain and adopt these types of things, they're going to need a different degree of centralization and blockchains with different twists and stuff. So yeah, couldn't agree more.
So I was going to say, on that note, what got you into Web3? How did you end up where you are?
I spent most of my time in technology consulting companies on like how they get work done. And like my niche was helping companies build alternative workforce models in their business and use freelance labor. Which is like growing segment of the workforce, and people want to move around fluidly and work for different projects. And it's a big opportunity for companies. But one of the big challenges in going to market with this first enterprise software startup was compliance. Like the labor legislation is super old. Like business leaders were very excited about this sort of business case, but then legal counsel would shut it down because of, you know, the headlines about Uber and all these lawsuits and stuff.
Right.
And then I did traditional consulting with heads of talent at big companies in that same field, and HR is siloed off from the business, and they only look after full-time hires and are not really open to change. And so I was really tired of like corporate bureaucracy and red tape getting in the way of doing things that were innovative and better. So what attracted me to blockchain was just how resource efficient it is to organize people and make a DAO or operate a company. Like it's a whole paradigm shift, because the old world model, the value of companies is in their intellectual property and their patents of tech and stuff. But in Web3, it's the value comes from the network of users and devs building apps on the protocol, if that's relevant. And those users have shared ownership in the app and the direction of these protocols. And so like Web3 is a really big paradigm shift in how work gets done, and the whole incentive alignment is much better. So I was crypto observer for a while and just trying to get in it and make a meaningful impact. So, and then I found Zeta Chain.
And so you're saying this is your first like a Web3 position then, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Very nice. Yeah.
That's very, very nice.
Yeah. So, but to get here, you know, it's like, and I think a lot of people are in this position where they're disenchanted with corporate life or whatever, and there's something about Web3 that really resonates and they want to go in this direction. And you know, you have to like network and contribute to Discords and try to build your resume and stuff. So
and it's such a small community. Like I know there's a lot of different chains, and like in the beginning of this podcast I said there's hundreds of them. But really there's like you know, quite a few that are very active and at every single event. So you're able to like meet a lot of different people. And like, I think what's so cool about this space is talking to the people that are building the future.
Yeah.
You know, like it's very difficult to go talk to, you know, like Tim Cook or, you know, Jeff Bezos, or because they're kind of controlling the Web2 space, right? This space, like, it's so up for grabs right now that there are a few different people that are like unattainable to talk to, but like, yeah, for the most part, there's a lot of people that are building the applications that are going to run the future, and from my perspective. And it's very, very cool being able to interact with these people at a personal level and kind of see what drives and motivates them.
Yeah.
And I think that's so mm-hmm. unique in our space specifically because they're willing to go get, you know, if you go to an event and you see a speaker, they're willing to go get a beer with you. They're yeah. willing to go talk with you. Like right now, you, for example, like we met you at your own event. Like you were very, very nice to us. We were like there with Galaxy as well.
Yep.
You guys were doing like a co-hosted event.
Team.
Yeah, great yeah. team. And like everyone is just so willing to kind of talk to you about what they're working on. And I think that's a refreshing start because a lot of times in Web2, it's so competitive and people are trying to cut each other's throats every single yeah. day. And it's not really, it doesn't feel like that yet in this space.
No, it's still exciting yeah. and expiring.
It's expiring.
Ideally not expiring.
Yeah. It's very, very inspiring. And it's yeah. very, very cool to be a part of. Like, was that kind of a culture shock for you too? Because I know like for us, some of the first Web3 events that we went to, I was just like, what is this? Like, this is yeah. wild. Like, this is such a crazy space. And it's so hard to explain to people. So we were like, all right, we got to get a cameraman and we got to go film this stuff because it is wild out there.
It is.
It's a wild technology. It impacts everything. You know, people talk about the rabbit hole and you can go as deep as you want. And for me, my connection was around the people and work. And that's how I arrived at it. But yeah, I agree. There's a sense of transparency. Again, all the design of blockchain, like I think that's what enables these types of interactions without getting too philosophical.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's this facade that it felt like I would bring in these corporate executive meetings and there you have to cater to internal politics at companies and you just realize how inefficient things are, which is like a natural effect of team scaling and stuff, but also like the old chain and command management structure. And this is just a better way. It feels better.
Yeah, totally agree.
Well, yeah, like with us, for example, our founders have come from Google. So like we're very flat. Like our organization's very flat. It's not like we have one person controlling everything. Like we definitely have a couple of managers or whatever that are in charge of like areas, but it's not micromanaging. It's not corporate. It's not, it's like today we'll talk about something and by Wednesday it's implemented or like we'll start working on an implementation for it.
It's a lot of room to make impact.
Yeah. We're like in that old Web2 space. It's like, there's so much bureaucracy that comes with it and people that are in control. And by the time you have something to do, it's been passed through like four or five different managers' hands.
Yeah.
So like, it's just very, very refreshing to be in a space where you can actually get a lot of work done, honestly. And I think that it really works out for a lot of people, specifically that are open-minded and able to kind of be unmanaged to control whatever they're in charge of.
It's a good space for ADHD.
That's very, very true. I'll
tell you that.
Can you tell us a little bit about your founders? You have 1, 2, 3, 5.
It's one founder.
Okay.
Yeah. So whom you met in San Francisco. So he was early Coinbase. He led their the product team that built Coinbase Wallet and their whole consumer app, and was one of the founders behind Basic Attention Token. He's been in the space for 10 years. He bore Zeta Chain in June of last year. Things happen quickly in this world, in the Web3 world. But, you know, same thinking. He noticed the fragmentation in the space and the associated risk because of that, and envisioned this new blockchain that would enable more consumer-friendly sort of default crypto apps, which I can't say that we have right now. Like we do in the Web 2 world, but not yet in Web 3. And so, yeah, the idea conceptually was, what if we had this blockchain that had full interoperability with all chains and layers, anti-fragmentation, no limitation in connectivity? And then when it came to actually mapping it out and like building the solution, he was he found someone in Discord, one of the lead Thorchain engineers. And for people listening, Thorchain was one of the first applications of native cross-chain token transfer, which we were talking about earlier. And this guy, Panru, would later become the CTO of Zeta Chain. He has a background in distributed computer systems, and he's a professor. And so they got together in person and started whiteboarding out what Zeta Chain would look like every day for a number of months, and started writing the white paper. Our head of product joined around that time, Brandon, and he was starting to set up the web presence of Zeta, and did all the design and visuals in the white paper. And then by the end of last year, December, the team had launched the first local DevNet environment, and the first draft of dev docs, and they were ready to scale a team around it.
Wow.
That's a pretty quick turnaround.
So right now, I mean, we mentioned a second ago, you just updated your testnet to include Bitcoin compatibility. What's sort of the product roadmap from here to the next like 6 to 12 months? Like what's your guys' next hurdles in terms of getting to, you guys don't have a mainnet yet, right?
Not yet. Q1.
So so is that kind of like Q1 of this coming year? So like January, like, wow. Okay.
Yes.
So that'll be exciting. It's very, very exciting.
It is. That's the big milestone. And the focus is on scalability, security of the testnet. We're doing auditing with third parties and all the table stakes stuff. The transaction volume on testnet right now is crazy. There's been 2 million cross-chain transactions. And so it's really stress tested the network. We're not going to see that traffic on day one because real value will be transferred in with mainnet, but we need to be prepared from a security standpoint. So all of this is super helpful in helping us optimize the testnet. And then we're working with partners to build out different omni-chain use cases that we think are important, and trying to open source smart contract examples for these things and UIs like the testnet environment that we have. Other projects can take that and build their own stuff. So we want to make it really easy to build a dev ecosystem around all of this.
Nice. With so like right now, kind of what we're going through internally and what a lot of different layer ones go through internally is starting to build out sort of the foundations within the actual foundation. So like the nonprofits that some people are attached to, or the labs, or like, where are you guys at with that? Are you guys still a for-profit? Are you guys going to run it as a for-profit? Do you know, like, this might not be a question you may or not be able to answer, but are you guys going to move to that? Like what was that like for you guys?
Yeah, that's a big question. The 5 to 10 year is for Zeta Chain to be a public DAO similar to that of Ethereum, and there'll be a foundation, and in the nearer future we want to have a grant program, and Zeta Chain is for profit, but the goal is to just reinvest back into building things to make Zeta have more utility and make more of a net positive impact on the world.
Okay. So from your perspective, let's get back onto you. So you said that you were originally from New York, right? If I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
And then now you're in Miami and you go to San Francisco, you go all over the place. What's been your favorite crypto place so far? Because obviously those are all three of those are like the hot spots in the United States for crypto. It's like, obviously, like, Miami's huge, New York's huge with NFTs. Obviously San Francisco is going to do San Francisco things and always built tech. So which one have you seen kind of been the best experience for you specifically?
In yeah. And I did a brief stint in Austin, Texas for a couple of years.
Oh, there you go. There's
Miami,
another huge one.
Right. Up and coming. It's up and coming everywhere, the meetups and stuff. And I haven't really broken in here in Miami. I think they have their pros and cons. Like, the in Miami, you're going to have the NFT influencers and Bored Ape types, which are fine. Just a different kind of character. It's hard to say. I think everything is so digital now. And so my interactions with our community, for example, it lives everywhere. So there are like 18 local language channels. There's a community-led meetup in Tokyo in a couple weeks, 100 plus people at a venue that we're going to fund. It's tough to pinpoint.
I mean, it's definitely like for us, it's really, really cool. And we get to experience all these different places.
Yeah. Different environment every time.
Yeah, exactly. And like here in Utah, it's not taken off yet. Let's just say that. Like, for example, like in San Francisco, you can have an event every single day. And yeah. I don't think people would blink an eye. Like, people would literally just be a part of it. And here it's like, we're lucky to get a couple a month, right? It's a very close-knit community, which is really, really nice. But in terms of the actual people in the space, it's not here yet.
Yeah.
Utah, but I mean, obviously Utah's Utah, so it's not necessarily, it's not exactly shocking that that's the way it is. It's just kind of like jealousy is what I feel towards you when I'm like, all right, well, Miami's really cool. There's a bunch of people there.
Absolutely.
But like, you know, you have the mayor or whatever saying that like, this is the crypto capital of the world. And like, you have San Francisco and then obviously New York is wild with NFTs.
Yeah.
So I'm super, super jealous.
I'm jealous the other way around because you have beautiful nature in Utah. And like, as fun as crypto is, it's also exhausting and it's good to get away from the screens and stuff. So the west of the US is pretty cool.
Yeah. And that's kind of, it's funny that you mentioned that because, yeah, at least in my experience with both Web 2 and Web 3, you have these developers that are so used to being in like cubicles and, you know, working all day. And they're kind of like these workhorses for their companies. And eventually they get to a point where they're like Nash's and Rusty's age, which is like if someone, these guys are obviously, Nash is our founder. Rusty's like our director of systems engineering here. But once you get to their age and their tenure, you're kind of like, you want to buy a farm and just like stay away from all of like normal life. So like everyone I know that's been in crypto forever ends up like buying a farm and just like disappearing. They get their Starlink and they never have to interact with anyone ever again. So maybe that's how we'll be in a couple of years.
It's a funny analogy because like, again, corporate world, 9 to 5 in the cubicle, it's like you work to get your carrot, but Web3 is giving you the farm.
Yeah.
If that resonates.
It really is. And I mean, it makes sense too, because like for us, you're absolutely right. Like decompressing here for people in Utah, it's, you're going on hikes, you are snowboarding, you are skiing, you are doing all this stuff. We have a few decent lakes. Obviously, it's not like Miami in terms of like boat life, but it, people do have boats here and it's very nice to kind of, you know, go into nature and decompress. And I think that's a big part of it because, I mean, this isn't necessarily even a joke. It's when you're out, like, and I know you probably have experienced this, when you have an event coming up or you're going to a space like San Francisco, you have to be on 24/7. Like that, there's no breaking. It's nonstop and you're constantly going forward. And some people burn out. It's just, it's 100% true, especially in this space. So I think it's important that you go out and you go experience life and like throw away your phone for like a couple of days and just go into the wilderness.
Yeah.
And I think that's important. Like very, very, very important.
100%. Yeah. I've been going to the WeWork around here. It's work, but you know, it's good. I was doing the remote work thing for a while. And people are social creatures. You got to get out there.
Yeah. I was looking into some of your past events, and there was one, and correct me if I'm mistaken, it was just kind of a glance. It was like Zeta Chain Global or something like that, where you kind of were like going all across the world and kind of teaching people about your chain, right? If I'm not mistaken, can you kind of talk a little bit about that? Because I thought that was really, really cool.
Thanks. Yeah. That was sort of how we positioned and marketed it, like the Zeta Chain Global Roadshow. And it's a thing. Like, we have a program where we're funding community events like the Eiffel Tower meetup next week. We had someone in Nigeria do a Web3 education seminar and talk about Zeta's impact. We did one in Belarus. And so we're advertising the opportunity to special contributors on our platforms. But yeah, we want to go all over the world. And I think if you're in Web3, you have a responsibility to onboard people into the space and get them onto these tools and stuff. So
yeah,
we'll try to do more of it.
So for people that want to take part in sort of what you guys are building on your team, how do they get involved? I mean, like, definitely plug whatever you want in terms of like Discord, socials, but like if your average, like, you know, smart contract developer, you know, how do they get involved with Zeta Chain? And like, at what point would it be advantageous for them to kind of reach out? You know, is it now? Like right now you want people in this space?
Sure. Yeah. So testnet is live. There's over 100 dApp contracts that people are working on. We don't know all of these parties, so people are experimenting. The docs are available. We have like an Ask Us Anything channel on Discord that our devs have eyes on. And we can do a call with them or set up a private Discord channel and coach them on the build. And we're developing that program and support model. If you're just a user, definitely join the testnet Zeta Labs and experience the Omnichain swap that we were talking about. And that'll make you eligible to mint NFTs on the Galaxy platform. If you want to get involved more strategically and meaningfully, we are now set up on Crew 3, which is a social quest platform. And we've outlined steps for how you can become a contributor, writing blog posts, doing TikTok videos, a ton of other ways. And so you'll get a special role. You'll meet a ton of cool people in our Discord. And you'll be along for the ride to mainnet.
Yeah. And I would also give like a huge shout out to whoever's building out your documentation as well. They're doing a very, very good job. I don't know if you have like a technical writer on your team or if that just kind of falling on the hands of your developers, but like your documentation is actually very easy to read and very easy to kind of like dive into. I would say like white papers are white papers. They're always going to be a little bit like, you know, collegey.
Yeah.
It's going to be very like PhD. So it's not necessarily like it's like a nice read, but I would say your actual technical documentation on your website is actually a pretty easy read. And like, it's easy to understand more or less how you interact with your, you know, with your environment. So I would give a huge shout out to that person too.
Yes. Thanks, Brandon and Lucas and the engineers. And we're trying to make it even better. Like, how can we make it easier for devs and equip them with these examples to make their apps multi-chain using cross-chain messaging or write these new omni-chain smart contracts? We're currently looking at inspiration from other companies and like how to make the docs more interactive.
Yeah. And I think that's a huge part of it too, is to get people interested. It has to be interactive and has to be at least not necessarily fun, but easy to be a part of it.
Right.
Like, obviously there's a lot of online web applications that kind of teach you how to use smart contracts and it's interactive and fun. And I think that drives a lot of traffic. Mm-hmm. So I think your head's definitely in the right space in terms of like getting people to interact with Zeta Chain a little bit more. I would say, you know, thank you, Jonathan. Like, it was such a pleasure meeting you. Like, your event, like, you've been really, really nice to us. Your founder was absolutely really, really nice as well. I've been able to interact with him a little bit on Telegram. I think you guys have a really good project. I really do. Like, a good team. Like, I think you guys, in terms of your community, it's like, I'd put you in the top echelon in terms of like how you want a community to be run. Mm-hmm. I really would.
Yeah.
So I think that's a huge kudos to you. Again, thank you for being on the podcast, dude. It means a lot to us, especially
nice to
learn.
Again, too.
Yeah, absolutely. To learn how you guys kind of do it over there. So thank you.
Of course. Yeah. Thank you so much for approaching us, and you guys have been super open, and I'm excited to collaborate more. So
cool.
Appreciate the invite. Too.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you again.
Thank you. Bye. Take care. Bye.
Thank you.